First World Order Radio. Finally, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right, all right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Order. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics. Radio. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
You have activated pioneer land in which I produced this black chemical called melanin.
What we did was gave a hard line in the sand between the different definitions of esoteric study and exoteric study. Playtime is over.
Yeah! South Shaolin, the classified elements. We here now. So all you Fruit Loop, colored candy, white, peanut butter and jelly, coon ass niggas. You best duck and run for cover. Yo, into the temple gates, cross the fiery lakes, for witness to tortured souls, and plans upon burning stakes. Ascend the cherubims, raising hell to reach heaven gates. Fire bombing cathedrals when I switch my cross to stay. Regard to animal, from animal back to God. The thorny truths like W.D.P.R.A.B. to raise a nation that's indispensable, indivisible, based on principle, relate to digital outputs to outlooks, temperatures rising as the sun of righteousness gives spiritual guidance in the lion's den. The phoenix arises, spitting balls for wars to the belt of Orion with the eye to Hootie. These faggot devils can't fool me. The phallus gave porn and digesting the pig's booty. The sin is the wickedness, lost in the wilderness. We're never at here to this. Go ahead and slit your wrist. The black guard exists. What devils try to exit, leaving their plan in crisis until destroyed by ISIS. In a pit of demons, I'm ancient Kemet dreaming, converting satanic hordes with the beta semen. Sword swinging, decapitator, parable addicted, crystal wand mystic, keeping glowing drinks when I'm lifted. I'm Mel-Chi-Zedek, moving through 50 states. Early trespagists with the gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I emanate golden rays above my head's a figure eight. I'm Mel-Chi-Zedek, moving through 50 states. Early trespagists with the gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I emanate golden rays above my head's a figure eight. In a devil's head, severed on a dinner plate. Before the throne of God, all devils will meet the fate. below the Mesa Dicks arises the future great imperial ferial sound the trumpets through the stereo murders of mics, that's why I scratch off the cereal. Reverse creation, send you back to some minerals. South Shaolin, double MC is the abbot. Morris be the nation, black man's land, we gotta have it. Restore the throne, I'd rather kick the savage. When disaster strikes, actual facts you can't manage. A fool's on deck, sink ships like Titanic. Spreading fear across the land, causing unjustified panic. Amongst the brain dead zombies, grabbing and spits abandons. While these wicked overseers collect residuals in their hammock. Corporate fruits forever remain rancid. Poison it to the mind, afflicted subconscious damage. I'm Mel-Chi-Zedek, moving through 50 states. Only transmittance, what their gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I am in a golden razor, but my head's a figure eight. I'm Mel-Chi-Zedek, moving through 50 states. Only transmittance, what their gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I am in a golden razor, but my head's a figure eight. Return of the ancient one, the Moorish Naga, the dragon rider, or breathing fire, generator, operator, destroyer, a self, lord and master, instructor, a Kama Sutra, practicing Tantra, a Kriya Yoga, a Kutalini, the resurrector, Shishuna, the eater, Pingala, awaken the seven chakra, to come the avatar, Muhammad the conqueror, putting swords to your jugular, send you to the ether, the water, air, fire, bender, the earth ruler, usher in the new era. In the saga, eyes filled with terror, eerie sounds of horror, reflection cracked mirrors, minds made feeble, dreams crumble, the curse tremble, thieves in the temple, raise the mental, beyond the four devils, you whack motherfuckers, you know what I'm saying, or you got them cool niggas out there, you know what I'm saying, yo, it's time to put that fucking rope around them goddamn throats, you know what I'm saying, cause you didn't know all this goddamn hip hop, that's why hip hop dead, motherfuckers.
To all the radio, back once again with your host, Dr. Alim Bey. We're going into I.C.G.R.O.M tonight, which is Indigenous Cosmic Golden RE Order of Mel-Chi-Zedek. So we will be getting busy tonight, so just hold on. We're getting ready to bring on my co-host, Brother Fahim L. You here, brother?
Ahate, Washitaw East.
Hey, Ahate, Washitaw East. Shaq, how you doing tonight?
Doing well, brother, doing well. How the God doing?
Excellent, 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 excellent.
All right,
we're going to be getting into I.C.G.R.O.M tonight, so we're going to be breaking down what is I.C.G.R.O.M. So we're going to be doing a little bit of question and answering. Matter of fact, it's going to be like a little flip this script like we've been doing with Brother Panic. We're going to have the High Priestess, Chieftain Julz El-Bey, to come on, and she's going to be actually flipping with me and asking me questions concerning I.C.G.R.O.M. So we're going to get into that right now. Let me bring her on. Peace.
Peace.
Yes, we got you.
Good.
Loud and clear.
Good. How y'all doing?
We're good.
Goodness. Yes. Glad to be talking about I.C.G.R.O.M, the Indigenous Cosmic Golden RE Order of Mel-Chi-Zedek. My first question is, on this new moon evening, we are recognizing that new moon in Gemini today. Why was I.C.G.R.O.M put together?
Well, actually, being that it's Gemini, Prince Bey was a Gemini, who was crown prince of Empire Washitaw Dugdahmoundyah. And in 2003, he came to us, and he already initiated several people in the Atlanta area. And he came to North Carolina and initiated us into I.C.G.R.O.M, in which that he was a member of the seven golden RE. All right, the seven golden RE. All right, and as being a member of the seven RE's, as we would say, he got authority to form his own order, in which that he formed the Indigenous Cosmic Golden RE Order of Mel-Chi-Zedek. Upon doing so, he came to North Carolina and initiated us into that order also. Our cipher, which was about maybe 30 at the time, appointed myself and my wife as being what we call the Grand High Priest and Grand High Priestess of I.C.G.R.O.M. Let me go into some of the information concerning I.C.G.R.O.M and what Prince Bey actually was putting together here. Because it's real powerful. And for those who don't know who Prince Bey is, let me go into some of that history also. All right. So, it was founded in 2002 after he was initiated into the Seven Golden Rays of Peru, and he took on the title P.R.A.B. Mel-Chi-Zedek, which was the acronym of Prince Ramisis Abel Bey, in which he became P.R.A.B., P-R-A-B, Mel-Chi-Zedek, and that was the name charged to form, and that was the name, you know, that he chose, in which that from there he charged to form his own order, calling it the I.C.G.R.O.M, or Indigenous Cosmic Golden RE Order, Mel-Chi-Zedek. Later on, he changed the name, his name, to Prince Hutan Tu'pak Bey. However, he kept the P.R.A.B. Mel-Chi-Zedek as part of the I.C.G.R.O.M name, and he told all of us to also add Mel-Chi-Zedek onto our names as part of the order. Okay?
Oh, wow. So that's on the end of everyone's name?
Right. Mel-Chi-Zedek is on the end of everyone's name as part of the order. We took it back not just to the biblical standpoint, but back to ancient Kemet, in which that becomes Malkhusutek. Malkhusutek is the name Mel-Chi-Zedek. But Malkhusutek is a name of Heru. And, of course, Heru symbolizes the awoken soul inside of our pineal gland. So, actually, Heru Malkhusutek would symbolize the pineal gland and the crown chakra being fully activated and the emergence of the lower self into the higher self. So it's the combination of the crowns on which that you would see on some of the pharaoh's heads in ancient Kemet, or pharaoh's heads, on which that you see the combination of the red crown, which symbolizes the chakras or the lower self, and the white crown, in which that symbolizes the higher self. The combination of both of them is actually Malkhusutek, which is Mel-Chi-Zedek. So hence you gain the totality of what we call Sematawi within ancient Kemet,
right,
which is the union of the two, the union of the higher self and lower self. That's basically what we would call it within the, I guess you could say, the Holy Quran, Circle 7, as well as also within the 101 and 102. They ask the question. The question is asked by Prophet Abu Dali, how many selves are there? And the answer is two, the lower self and the higher self. And it says, well, what does the lower self do? Is the lower self does everything in which they're harmed. Well, what, you know, does the higher self? What is the higher self? The higher self is the mother of virtues. So it's a combination of the masculine and feminine force, which is androgynous within the physical body, in which that is symbolic to Hiru Malkhusutek. When you see on the walls of ancient Kemet the crocodile fat being poured over top of the anointed initiate by Heru and Tahuti or Jehuti, them two together, Heru and Tahuti, actually form the principle of Mel-Chi-Zedek within the Bible. All right? So this is what I want people to understand, is that when you're talking about Mel-Chi-Zedek, you're actually talking about the crown chakra, all right? And anyone who reached that level of consciousness, which is within the immortal body, actually become a high priest, a high priestess after the order of Mel-Chi-Zedek, all right? So that's what we attempt to initiate people into, is to into their higher self, so they can, you know, stop being so immersed, you know, within their lower self.
Wow.
Wow, yeah.
So let me say this too about Prince Bey, because, of course, you know, he went through Christianity, Islam, Judaism, Hebraism, the Morrison Temple. He was a member of the of Temple 21 there in Atlanta, Georgia. He actually was also the secretary of the MSTA. He was also part of the Order of the Sufi Brotherhood. Like I said earlier, he was the he was initiated into the Seven Golden Rays of Peru. And the high members gave him authority. Their names was Lord
Missimo, and Yogi, what's his name, Chris, well, Christopher Brooks, I'll go by that name, I'll give that name, in which that told him go inform, he didn't have the right to go inform that order. He also studied up on the Round Nephil, also a fifth society. He was a member of AMARC, which is the Ancient Mystic Order of the Rose Cross.
Mm.
He also was part of the Hare Krishna movement, the Eagle Wings Institute, and founder of the Holy Temple of Menelik. All right, so that's just a few things in which that prince played. He also was the Crown Prince of Empire Washitaw Dugdahmoundyah, given that title June 7th, 1999, which was his birthday, was June 7th. So he's also a Gemini, and so this is only right to bring everything together in the Gemini sun. And of course,
right,
this new moon, as we're talking about, is going to be, huh?
They're right, Gemini, new moon today.
Mm-hmm.
Right, exactly. Right, so some of his other achievements was actually he's a spiritual advisor, intuitive psychic, tarot card reader, rune reader. He was initiated into the Yoruba by actually Tupac's aunt. Right, the sister of Asada of Shakur, as well as also Tupac's mother, Prince Bey, referred to as his godmother. Shaman, he was a shaman healer. He's initiated to the traditional Ushi Reiki healing system, the pranic healing, instructed Qigong. He taught me all of this back in the early 90s, mid 90s. He basically was a magician. He also was a musician. He played the drums.
Wow.
He also sang.
Yeah.
He also sang. When he first got into the, when he first got into with the Empress, part of the Washitaw Dugdahmoundyah, he was the bodyguard for the Empress. He also was a student of Moses Powell, Grandmaster Moses Powell.
When you talk about Prince Bey,
mm-hmm.
when you talk about Prince Bey, that's a lot of knowledge.
Yeah, it is.
Exactly.
Pull together to put
right.
this together. To put
yeah,
this together. So that, and,
yeah.
Right, that leads
yeah.
into the next question, because, you know, this is it's a spiritual order. So what would you say, considering all the things that Prince Bey was into and the outlines that he set up for us within this order, when, you know, naturally a person would ask, you know, well, does the Indigenous Cosmic Golden RE Order of Melchizedek, is that a religion? What's the religion within that? Is there a religion within it?
Let's look at the word religion and take it back to religo, which is the Latin name for it, which means to be bind back or tied back. What is he being bind or tied back to? It is nothing more than your higher self, your God, you know. So, yes, it's a religion. In that sense, you are attempting to bind you back to your higher self, back to your God, your Lord, a personal Savior, not to my God, Lord, a personal Savior, not to someone else's God, Lord, a personal Savior. Nothing to look, make you look outside yourself, but always look within yourself for your answers in order to move forward on your, you know, in this journey called life. So
mm-hmm.
in that sense, a religion. But Prince Bey was ordained minister of the Afrocentric Temple, as well as also an ordained member, minister of the ancient Coptic Church. So in that regard, and as he said, he also was a secretary in the MSTA, More Science Temple of America, Temple 21. So when we look at that, you know, we understand that just like it is on the MSTA card, that we honor all the prophets, we honor Jesus, Muhammad, you know, Confucius, you know.
Right.
You know, and
right.
our Holy Cross, Krishna, you know. You know, so ask the same thing as far as a religion, not a religion per se, but to be a faith belief system in that regard. We take the best of all the so-called religions and apply them and see the things in which that works the best for us. In other words, this is now the foundation of a culture that we are developing.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not more so, it's not so much so a religion, but more so a development of a culture that we are attempting to do. So anyone from any of the various schools of thoughts can come and become initiated into the order of Melchizedek. So that don't matter. It doesn't matter if you're Palomayambe, Makan, Ifa, if you're also a sect, if you're Freemason, you know, if you're a Rosicrucian, it doesn't matter. You know, we encompass all of that, you know, because we understand that this is about holistic thinking.
Right. What you just was talking about Prince Bey being initiated, there's folks out there initiated in several different orders. And just as a as another question along with that, because I deal with that from time to time when, you know, you tell folks that you have, you know, they ask, well, what's your religion? You know, because they see you, you know, walk a certain way and carry yourself with a certain light. They wonder, okay, well, what are you into that's having you walk like that? And then when you answer, oh, well, I'm, you know, I have, you know, I'm into Sufism, and I'm, you know, he was into, obviously that's Gnostic Christianity. Sufism is, you know, basically esoteric Islam, and you're saying that he was, you know, in the ancient Egyptian order.
Right, he was the order of the Sufi Brotherhood. He was a member of the order of the Sufi Brotherhood. Mm-hmm.
Right. So, you know, just for the listeners, you when I get asked that question, well, aren't you, no, that just leads to confusion because you're in all of these different things. There's only one God. Can you address that question?
Of course, it's very easy. Yes, one God in which that has many attributes in which that people misinterpret as far as to be religion, when it's nothing more than attributes of God in which that all leads back to the same path. But it depends on what fits for you, the individual. If you're comfortable worshiping a white man who's supposed to come out the sky or who died for your sins 2,000 years ago, then so be it. For those who are not into that, then, of course, they look for something else. You know, everyone does not have to worship a white man coming out the sky waiting to be saved. You know, how idiotic does that sound? But that's exactly what the majority of our people are doing. So,
exactly.
Until they can bypass that, please don't ask me no questions about a belief system because you can't even get past mythology, you know, that they're dealing with. Let alone trying to ask someone a question about, doesn't that lead to confusion? There's only one God, like you said, so how does that lead to confusion?
Right.
You know?
Right. Right.
First, it's confusion because they can't see God within themselves because they're so busy putting their energy and efforts outside of themselves trying to be so right, you know, and in return actually being so wrong.
Yes, that's a little bit of a paradox to say there's one God, but which one do you worship?
Exactly.
So you're contradicting yourself.
Exactly.
There's one God, so, you know.
One God.
Listen, you can't be doing all
one
these
faith,
different,
one
yes, you can't be into all these different things. And yes. So with that being said, what are some of the basic principles of the order?
Well, our motto is basically know thyself and you will know the universe and God. Of course, that is an ancient Egyptian or ancient African proverb, so we go by that. Of course, you know, that was on the temple walls and over the temples throughout Egypt. Our symbol is the eight-pointed star, in which that is called the star of Osar. That is our star. As well as also, when you go to the scripture, you have the Melchizedek priesthood, which is, of course, greater than the priesthood descended from Abraham, descended from Aaron, of the Leviticus priesthood who was greater than that. This is why Hebrews the 15th and the 17th chapter, as well as also Psalms 110, God emphatically swore that the Messiah would be a priest after the order of Melchizedek. Because the Messiah, which is the Melchizedekian priest, all of that symbolizes a higher level of consciousness. All right? Mm-hmm. So we understand that, to its fullest. Our mission, I guess we'll say, a question could be asked, well, why indigenous? Well, this, of course, Prince Bey, belongs to the East Nation, like you said. He was the crown prince of the Empire of Washitaw, Dugdahmoundyah, under the auspices of His Highness, the Empress Verdiacee Tiara, Tunica, Washitaw, Goston El-Bey, who bestowed his title, crown prince, like I said, June 7th, 1999. So that's the reason why we deal with the indigenous aspect. Some of the things that Prince Bey wanted us to master was signs of ancestral acknowledgement, historical research, religious studies, ecology, also with geophysics, astrology or cosmology, archaeology, anthropology, as biochemistry or genetics, all right? Some of the healing sciences that he wanted to go into was, of course, Reiki, pranayama, yoga, which is actually pranic healing, naga yoga, which is kundalini, tantra kriya yoga, electromagnetic modality, massage, suggestion, dealing also with hypnotism and projection of thought. All right? These are things that he worked on. Also, of course, herbalism and herbology. So these are just some of the aspects. Also, he wanted us to develop free healing services twice a week with meditation and prayer, chanting, dhikkaring, doing those sounds of power, hesis or hekau, or mantras and mudras, science of breath, song, and rhythmic dance and drumming. Some of the other things he wanted us to get into was communication with the higher self, also with the ancestors, but no demonology. In other words, no blood sacrifices, for they are not necessary, for the universe is abundant with pranic energy, which is actually red light blood. So it is actually the light force pulsed through or cosmic energy, in which we actually are dealing with. Even though he was initiated into the Yoruba, I remember he asked his godmother, Tupac's aunt, about, why is sacrifice necessary when the universe is abundant with energy? Is it not, necessary or possible to actually bypass a blood sacrifice and tap directly into the universal life force, being that it is one and the same? She stated, yes, of course, but most people have not mastered Ori, which is the science of the mind yet. So that means that all these particular rituals is just to get you, it's just a tool to get you to the point of being able to tap into the deeper conscious levels of the mind. All right? We always speak about the different levels of consciousness. We talk about the seven consciousness, interpersonal consciousness, intrapersonal consciousness, life consciousness, subconsciousness, superconsciousness, magnetic consciousness, and infinite consciousness. So once you master all these particular tools, you can actually begin to start going into your higher self or going into infinite consciousness and becoming one with your higher self. And therefore, these particular things are no longer necessary. All right? So that's what he was actually trying to teach us, is that we can go beyond the blood sacrifices and all these things. It wasn't necessary. He also spoke about mastering of your diet, herbal practices, personal hygiene practices, as well as also spiritual cleansing. Some things that he said that we can start selling or doing is actually selling the fruit, growing and selling the fruit. He healing edibles, herbal remedies, incense, soaps, oils, ointments, bath salts, and et cetera. All
right? Right. Also, that does appear to be, when you look on the DrAlimElBey.com under Indigenous Cosmic Golden RE Order Melchizedek, you'll see that there's a lot of references towards healing. That seems to be the main mantra of the order, is helping folks to heal with, you know, the different skills that, you know, folks will come into the order, those that get initiated and those that are, you know, even members, that the goal is to help folks heal, which is, that seems to be, you know, you look at the different holy books from all over the world, and that is one of the main points, is that, you know, if you are a divine person, then your presence alone would heal people.
Exactly.
So,
and that's absolutely true.
Right. And everything that you just spoke of, that seems to answer the next question about the daily practices that we should be doing every day. You know, if you're involved with I.C.G.R.O.M at all, the daily practice is to heal oneself so that when you go out into the world, you're not causing any problems or harm to anyone, including yourself.
Right.
Would that be correct?
Definitely.
Okay.
That would be definitely one of the things that we master in you. And we master that through the science of breath. The more we learn how to breathe correctly, properly, then, you know, then these things will be mastered. We speak about our purpose, you know. They told us to bestow members of high moral standards and raise members to their ultimate spiritual level. That's our purpose, all right? Also, to live in universal order, cosmic alignment, and in tune with nature, all right? Also, to maintain love, to seek freedom and justice, righteousness, integrity, right. Also to build health and wellness centers, educational institutes, farms, and et cetera. This is why we have our land dedicated to that, because that's what he told us. Also to learn natural law, you know, so that deals with the laws of nations, linking ourselves back to the family of nations. Also common sense law or reasoning, human rights laws, as well as indigenous laws, which is international law. Also to establish theaters, museums, temples, mosques, churches, shrines, harmonistic principles and practices, or natural progressive forms of worship. To study, like you said, chemistry, alchemy, biology, ecology, you know, all these sciences that bring balance and connection for humanity. All right, so these are all the things in which that we are told to do under the order.
Right, I have some from folks coming in to next month's event on June 28th. And one of the questions they had specifically was, you know, well, what should I study in order to prepare myself for this initiation?
Well, everything is on the website as far as the offices and things. We spoke about our mission, our purpose, as well as also our motto, but the offices and duties of each one is there. So they can always go and study what it is. What, now, the question is, what is I.C.G.R.O.M? It's an order of love, love of self, love of higher self. You know, that's what it is, that we may interact without a divine love. That's what we're supposed to be doing.
Right.
We have different things. You know, as we're putting everything together, formulating everything, we have the offices of the Supreme Grand High Priest, Priestess, the Grand High Priest, Priestess, which is to lead meetings, address difficulties, enforce laws of the order, to issue ordinance and help in the evaluation of candidates. Then we also have the order of the office of captain, which is, let me give the Kemetic names too while we had it. You have the Ida Netter or Netcher, which is the grand
right.
high priestess, which is the captain, which is to lead, teaching methods, oversee security, and maintain peace in the order of light. We also have the order of lieutenant, which is Inikat, which is to build and assist the captain, grand high priest, and helping the maintenance of the priesthood. We also have the office of secretary, which is the record keeper or treasurer, which is Sesh Perunk, which is the recorder, which is same as Tahuti, and the archiver of all meetings, as well as the banker and financier of the order. We also have the office of the high priest, which is Habet, which is actually for all, the Wa and the Wabet, which is male and female, which is the office, which is actually to uphold all facets of the veil in the covenant. And what is the veil and covenant? Basically, is love thy mother and thy father, love thy neighbor as thyself. That's the veil and covenant. All right, so we have the position, you know, like we said, Prince Bey been initiated since 2002, and we've been initiating since 2004.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Along
Right.
So actually, the order been together now for actually 12 years. Actually, 12 years. All right?
Wow.
So, the thing is just, you know, reading the information that's on the website, it tells you everything that you need to know about the order, of the different positions, and how you can move within the order yourself.
So then, and to fill the positions of the, that would be up to the Supreme Grand Priest and Supreme Grand Priestess, correct? Depending on the person's personality, or is that
where they feel that they would fit at as far as part of their house or order. You know,
right.
Like for example, we have to, I give you a good example, you have to, Wab and the Wabat, which we've been talking about, which means pure priest or priestess. They're responsible for the purity of the rituals and the cleanliness of the sacred rooms, the tools, the paraphernalia, and the priesthood. All right, then you have the Udnet, which is along with the scribes of the House of Life, of the Udnet, or Nut, or the astrologer, or the cosmologist. You know, the priests and priestess who calculate the positions of the sun, moon, and stars and the planet. All right, so for those who are interested in that house, then that's the house that we belong to. You have the Kerhad, who was the priest and priestess who decided the magical spells, and the ones who did the ritual.
Mm-hmm.
You have the Sashpray, who describes the House of Life, who learned the priesthood, who taught mathematics. They were the mathematics or the mathematicians. They were the doctors, the scientists. And you have the Seshkan, who was the artist of the priesthood. You have the Sinu, the priest who's involved in, with healing. All right, so, and you have the Raket. All right, so, in other words, these particular positions will actually be put in front of the name, but Malkum Sutek would be, which is Mel-Chi-Zedek, would be put at the end of their name. As part of the order. That way we know what house each one belongs to.
Right. Right.
Like, for example, another one, Raket. Raket means wise woman. They were the seers or the prophetesses or prophets, of Ikram, the prophetesses of Ikram. They're the ones who communicated with the spirit. And then you have the Saur, who are the workers of protective magic. You have the Duwat, Netter, which means to be in tune with the forces of nature, the worship of God, with the title carried by the priestess of Heru. You know?
Right.
So there's all these titles in which that fits everyone who wants to participate in this particular order. You have the Hine, they are the temple musicians and dancers. You have to say,
right.
who are the funeral, they presided over the funeral rites, you know, and, you know, so everyone, you know, it's a society, as you see, you know, is it actually a nation? This is actually the spiritual side of the Washitaw, or in particular, United Washitaw, Dugdahmoundyah. So
right.
Everyone will have to be indigenous, you know, to understand, you know, this to the highest order, you know, as far as our job, you know, our career path, you know, or life mission,
mm-hmm.
as you say.
Now, with the different orders of priests and practitioners of spirituality within ICRM, in general, what would these practitioners be empowered to do within their communities?
Well, number one, we would teach them signs of business so that they can go out and actually put together the order in which that they fall up under, you know, in their community. They can begin to start teaching classes. We can also show them how to put together an unincorporated church or affiliation of that sort, in which that they can, you know, utilize, you know. So it's the same thing in which that we are learning, you know, as Moors, as far as dealing with the law aspect, these same things will be also taught to the high priest and priestesses so that they
Peace.
I'm still on in the air. Something. He'll be back on in a little bit.
All right. Yes, this is very interesting.
Yes, it is. Very enlightening.
Some of these things, especially Melchizedek being Heru, and with the Prince Bey being involved in so many different religious
sciences. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
That is a lot. That is a lot. No. You just figure, you know, how much time the average person has in their day and the things they're, you know, able to do to be involved, you know, with just one religion. There's lots of things that you have to do. And to be involved in several, you have to be a very high and mighty person.
Very,
you know, upstanding. And your character has to be impeccable.
Oh, yeah.
So it's good to know that that's the kind of mindset that started the order. That started the order because, you know, and then to be able to walk amongst all these different folks, you know, not just to be an attendee of their ceremonies, but to actually, you know, be initiated, to become initiated because, you know, I've talked to folks that have tried their best to get initiated in different things and have tried for years and still just don't, for whatever reason, don't get it. They don't get into one. So
right.
Here, Prince Bey was in several different orders.
Right.
That is amazing.
Yes, it is. And the reason they don't get it is because they're not on the level that they need to be on, you know, in order to, for that to sink in to them. You know, a lot of them has, like the religions, different religions, and they're stuck on different religions and belief systems
that
the European has provided for them, and they taught their children, their children's children, their children's children's children from generations, generations, and generations on down, and it's really embedded in them, and they can't let these go. That's why they cannot get with the different sciences of the Rosicrucianism and Yoruba, excuse me, and all of it, which is more science, you know, but they can't really get into that because they're not ready to let this other stuff go, you know.
Right.
feels it's against their belief. You know, that's what
right.
that's about.
That was interesting too to hear that he was into Yoruba, because you know it's one thing to get into different religions from this side of the water, and to get into, you know, that is a real accomplishment to get involved in religions that, you know, started or are still heavily practiced within Africa.
Mm-hmm.
That is not an easy task.
No.
I do know folks that have, you know, are still going through their training to become Yoruba priests and priestesses.
Mm-hmm.
So that's you know, to hear that, I guess, to hear that, he was into, you know, so many different things that I personally know are challenging. You have to pass because it's not on. And then also, you know, it's one thing to be ordained in the flesh or, you know, on paper,
mm-hmm.
you know, to go through, you know, and, you know, do the book study, but to actually be ordained in the spirit.
Right.
Ether, that's a whole different ballgame.
Yes, it is.
A whole different ballgame that, you know, you have to have a certain light within your aura and your chakras and your chi
right.
and your heart to vibrate at a level where all of these, you know, different spiritual sciences are made available to you to become a part of.
Right, that's so true. Yes. But it's like I say, it's a different... you know, religious beliefs of these religious systems that they have been involved with and
mm-hmm.
bought a lot of this stuff that they, you know, things that's been handed down to them won't allow them to sink into a lot of the Yoruba science and the Rosicrucian science and Masonry and the Hare Krishna, the Krishna movement. It won't allow them
mm-hmm.
to, you know. It you know, they're stuck. They won't come out of that box that they're in. They got to learn how to
right.
come out of the box, you know. And that's their real problem.
That's true, because that's something else as well. Where I do know folks where they
mm-hmm.
try to, you know, they have an international approach to everything that they do, so.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even in their spiritual practices, they can go, you know, hang with the Muslims, and then go and deal with the Buddhists, and then go, you know, another day and participate in, you know, different African spiritual systems.
Mm-hmm.
In some cases, once one so-called spiritual house finds out about this person traveling to these other places of spiritual worship, then, you know, they say, well, you can't come here no more because,
right.
you know, you can only, our way is the only way, and if you ain't doing it our way, then you're not
right.
doing it right.
Right.
Yeah,
that's you know, egotism.
Well, see, this is the thing, that in order to be initiated, the requirement into I.C.G.R.O.M., actually one must be willing to relinquish the grip of the ego over one's behavior, deeds, and actions. And rightfully
mm-hmm.
desire the emergence into their higher self. So that
right.
is actually one of the cues.
Right.
That is. Mm-hmm. That is the key.
To be able, especially, you know, all religions, as far as all the ones that I've encountered, there's a attribute of the divine that's omnipotent and omnipresent. So to say that, you know, you go to one place, you go to the temple, and then you go to the synagogue, and then you go to the mosque, and then you go to the church, and if you weren't able to see the divine in each of those places in any way, shape, or form, then that, you know, how they say the beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing.
Yeah.
Same thing.
Yeah. There is divine in all of them. You know, Christianity, but you know a lot about their Christianity that the Christians don't know.
Right.
So you know what the preacher is saying probably better than the preacher does. And, you know, the esoteric meaning of of what they do in those churches a lot more than the church members themselves. And the same as the mosque. The mosque, you know, a lot of the esoteric meaning of the also the Sufi meanings, actually, of Islam.
Right.
And most Muslims don't know. And
they was laughing at me, as a matter of fact, when I did the video, the metaphysical decoding of the mystic of our Islam.
Mm.
And you know, I was still only in my early 30s, so they was like, "What the hell do you know about the mysticism?" And I was getting laughed at, you know, in a sense, in New York,
because
you know, they couldn't believe that someone just 30 years old, because this is something in which that a person wouldn't reach, you know, until they were probably in their 50s, you know, when they become a shack,
right,
you know, at the age of 50. But because, you know, I was, you know, diligent in my research and study, you know, once people began to start seeing what I was talking about, they was like, yo, he got something in it. He
mm-hmm.
knows what he's talking about. But that's because you have to work on this thing daily. You know, like another principle, there's several other principles on which that Prince Bey taught us. He stated that you must possess high moral standards and is able to withstand the temptations of the world. One must also learn to develop detachment from reaction and wrong desire.
Mm-hmm.
There's another one in which that he said one must be willing to work daily through proper breathing, meditation, prayer, which is also song or chant or dhikr or mantra or mutra,
mm-hmm.
exercise such as dance, your living, which is your diet, as they would say, to develop one spiritual, mental, conscious gift, which is called your settings, within the Sanskrit, or what is called within 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, the fruits, the nine fruits of Christ. But this is what we're supposed to be working on. You know, and when you go and do the research, what the nine fruits of Christ are, you will find that is speaking in tongues, interpreting in tongues, discernment of spirits, miracles, healing, knowledge, wisdom, understanding, you know, all of these keys are part of 1 Corinthians 12 chapter, part of this system in which that we must learn. He also stated that one must learn how to focus on one's earthly mission and spiritual purpose in life and one's intentions in every situation. Now, that's the hardest thing to do, but we have to learn how to start doing that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So the question should be asked, what is your soul mission? And what do I have to give to the world? That is what we ask each initiate. What is it that you have that you can give to the world?
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
Right. Because there's not a lot of focus on that, you know. Your own personal destiny, your own personal purpose, why you as a person were sent here. Because, yes, you know, there's reincarnation and all of that, and you have
mm-hmm.
karma from different lifetimes. But this specific incarnation, it holds lots of value and it's very important. So, you know, divining and finding out what that is and being confident in that and being able to perform it, there are a lot of obstacles in the way.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if you're into, you know, the mainstream distractions.
Right.
Yeah. But this is what I remember. I read a good book. It's called The Path of the Master. And it's by Raha. And he stated that the master may speak and act through his body much the same as others do. Yet in reality, he is supreme one who is acting and speaking. He is no longer a mere man with clouded and limited understanding, but a man who has become God and a God who has become man.
Mm. Mm.
Mm-mm-mm.
So this is what we have to realize. This is the supreme, highest understanding of disorder, and what I just stated.
Yeah, the higher understanding of yourself, the more you study yourself, and you gain a higher understanding of yourself. You know,
right.
And you know, the more you do that, the more you be ready to the other sciences of the world that you get into. you know. And a lot, like I say, you know, even in the Prince Hall Masonic Order. Actually, I didn't join the Prince Hall Masonic Order to learn anything. I joined the Prince Hall Masonic Order to teach, because
right.
I understand a lot of their Masonic rituals a lot more better than most of them in that order.
Right.
No, so it's like the same as the church, the synagogues, and the mosques, the cathedrals, and the temples. You know, even in some of the more science temples in the different cities, the temples are more more science temples incorporated, because you understand they're more science, more better than most of the more brothers and sisters in those temples. Because a lot of them has been compromised, so therefore they're not going to teach or what we're talking about tonight, or talk about
right.
what we're talking about tonight. You know,
exactly.
And in the,
that's one of the things too. That's one of the things too about the brotherhood is that, you know, they ostracize membership in some sort. You know, between the males and the females. You know, the only time they can interact is during a particular function. But in this particular order, we don't do that because we understand the secret gospel of Mary, chapter 1, verse 123, where it says, Mary said, if Christos can appear as male, then surely Christos can appear as female. Those who deny holiness in womanhood do not understand holiness in manhood or womanhood, but are solely bound to ignorance. Do not believe the father of lies, but believe in the mother spirit, whose name is the spirit of truth and comforter. Hence, the mother of virtues, which is, i.e., the higher self. So do not believe in the father of lies, which is the lower self, but believe in the mother spirit, whose name is the spirit of truth and comforter, which is the higher self. Muhammad symbolizes that comforter, as mentioned within the book of John, which is symbolic to the higher self, which is, i.e., really the crown chakra. Not a man from just 1,400 years ago, as they would have us to believe, because the name Muhammad was not even an Arab name. It was an ancient Egyptian or Kushite name, which that was referred to. Hapi, who was the River Nile god, who brought us to Rem, which is the word Salam, which means peace. Yes. Right, so Ahmed ibn Abdullah Mustafa, who we call Prophet Muhammad of old, or 1400 years ago, if he had relatives in Kushite or Kush, which was Ethiopia, in which that he learned of these stories and he took on that title, which became the name Muhammad. Remember, his name originally was Ahmed. His name was not Muhammad. So we have to understand that these keys in which that is given to us, you know, by way of the Hadith, by way of the Quran, by way of these other so-called inspired scriptures, how all of this information fits together. And essentially, it's all talking about you.
Exactly.
Right. That's something that, you know, you can go to some religious houses every week and not find that out. And, you know, for us, it's, you know, that's common knowledge. That's you know, that's almost in every conversation. You know, you're looking for yourself. Are you looking for yourself? Have you found yourself?
Right.
The questions along those lines. So, you know, ages ago, that was considered blasphemy. So we are in a very different time where, you know, that's allowed to be talked. That conversation can be had. Outside of, you know, just the top clergy. Now, some of the questions that we had were in regards to next month. Next month is, you know, we're having an initiation June 28th and 29th in Kelly, North Carolina, where folks can come and get more information, and they can enjoy different ceremonies and learn about different healing modalities. But what specifically should those that are coming to find out more about this order be prepared for? In what ways can they prepare themselves?
Mm-hmm.
And what should they expect?
Well, they will be able to expect the first day, which is the 28th, we'll be going over the various sciences of the order. We will be going also into the science of healing, the science of breath, so they will be learning that information, the science of colors, the science of thought, the science of pranayama, also dealing with the kundalini yoga, nadi yoga. They will learn all these particular arts. They will also learn aspects of qigong and tai chi to build energy. They also will, we are actually putting together also as part of the initiation, what we call a lodge. We call it Indian lodge. That's what people want to call it. Some refer to it as a top, as also as a sweat lodge. That would be also part of the initiation. We will have a sweat lodge, in which that initiates is also go through as part of the initiation process, in order to help rid themselves of toxins and poisons, purify them, and also build their endurance, and build and also help to attune them to their higher self. Because after so many minutes in the sweat lodge, some people tap into their higher selves, and that's what we want to do. So we have the sweat lodge, and we're going to, we are also putting together for the initiation process, as well as also people will be initiated into the various healing modalities, such as Reiki, pranic healing, you know, different other arts, as you said earlier, as well as also it will be initiated into the order of Mel-Chi-Zedek, which is a separate initiation itself, and we will be doing that probably on that Sunday. All right, so those 2 days, that is what to expect, is clarity on the initiation, clarity on the order, and the mastery of self.
Great. Now with the sweat lodge, I've done that a couple of times. The sweat lodge is a serious experience.
That's what I heard.
It's a very serious experience. Even for those whose third eye have not been awakened as of yet, you will still have an experience because that feeling on it's a very physical, and it penetrates so deep that, you know, as those toxins are being released through your pores, via sweating from every place on your body, different healing chemicals and secretions are released as well. And so, you know, you may have a vision and you may have an experience, you may feel things. So I want to advise everyone, you know, if you're coming, you want to do the sweat lodge, make sure you drink a good amount of water the day before so that you have something to sweat out.
That's right, yeah.
Because, you know, usually when I go to a sweat lodge, you have to drink twice as much water as you normally drink, at least twice as much water as you normally drink the day before, because a lot of folks aren't into hydrotherapy. And, you know, part of hydrotherapy is making sure that your water, the water in your system, what are we, at least 80% water, now they're saying, a physical body is at least 80% water. And if you don't constantly change, if you don't constantly, you know, add in water daily, it's a lot like a fish tank. And if you can't imagine never changing the fish tank water, you know, imagine doing that to your body and to your system. So when you go to a sweat lodge, it's good to drink, again, it's good to drink a lot of water the day before so that that water changes over. You know, you let the impurities get flushed out of your system through that, you know, eliminative sensitive organ is your skin. And, you know, you'll have a clean and healthy water system available that's already, you know, you drank the day before. So is there anything that they should bring with them? I know from my experience, you bring towels.
Yeah,
bring a good amount of towels.
Right. Wear some sweat.
Sometimes they like. Sometimes they say to bring the bathing suits so that
right.
Because you really
right.
Get that sweat on.
Exactly. Right. Right.
Right. Right. And then after I had a questions as far as life after you get initiated, the responsibilities that you know that folks are expected to perform and, you know, fulfill their duties.
Right. Well,
so once they finished,
before everyone leaves, we would see what house in which that they're interested in, and then we would play them which that which give them some ideas on what they need to do. We have a booklet in which that I wrote back in 2003, which is called I.C.G.R.O.M, Protocols of I.C.G.R.O.M. They will receive
mm-hmm.
that book, along also with instructions on how to develop their house so when they get back to their particular area. So that's what we're going to be working on. And out of the houses, there always must be some council or representative for that particular house, because during particular events, we will want the members to be there, you know, in order to move the order forward and see what is the best, you know, things, solutions, remedies in which that we come up with for our people. And we're not just talking about the order people, we're talking about our people in general, because this information is spread out. This is a public connection. This is not just private, you know, in which that, you know, a lot of orders or a lot of groups or societies that we see, they like to keep to themselves and just keep, you know, within, you know, their particular confines, you know, their particular connection or clique.
Mm-hmm.
This is not what this is.
No. No. And as an example of that,
yeah.
the other day,
drives, shoe drives, food drives, feed the homeless, all these things will be implemented, you know, as part of the order. You know, taking care of the poor, you know, housing,
mm-hmm.
the homeless, all these things will be getting something part of that. Like you said, homeschooling, you know, we have a curriculum for homeschooling. Actually comes from Brother Cobb, which is Booker T. Coleman. He gave it
mm-hmm.
to us last year. So we have the curriculum that we can utilize. Also, information comes from Brother Marcus Cry. I used to write for the Frontline Magazine back in 2002, 2004, etc. He also has developed a school program, you know, so all these things can be implemented in order to help tell our stories.
Now, once those folks go back home, once they go back home, do they have to notify anyone? Do they have to register, to your knowledge, in order to be, you know, allowed to perform their duties?
Not about being allowed. It's about being able to bring something to the table. So we will have we can start having conferences so that we can see what everybody is doing in their various areas in order to see what things need to be delegated, you know, at that particular time, you know, like, for example, fundraising, what can be done, you know, as far as bringing donations in, and then thinking of what we can do with the donations, you know, are we going to feed the homeless with it, are we going to, you know, build, you know, I guess you would say put together within their territory, various territories.
Mm-hmm.
So what I really want to see is us pooling in money and then within each territory
mm-hmm.
finding property and put together a temple in that way or a church in that way, if we would say, and the school and everything happens within that area.
Mm-hmm. Right.
One of the places that we're talking about taking over, in which that we have connection with, is actually Detroit. We have members who actually part of the order who actually go and bought prime property, blocks of property. They're in Detroit. Matter of fact, we have our first church.
That's what religious. That goes into another thing, another aspect of this, because you know once you get ordained with an ikram, that is coming from divine authority. But notice that you know churches or different religious houses that. Operate under 501c3 because you mentioned earlier about the unincorporated status. You become 501c3, you're not getting ordained. If you operate under that, you're not becoming ordained under divine authority. That's coming from the state, correct?
Right.
Or the federal government. Can you talk about the difference?
Right, exactly.
What that implies?
Right. Well, unincorporated association or organization, nonprofit organization, particularly. What that does is that you are responsible for the things in which that you take care of, the donations, contributions that which come in, the IRS cannot just come in and try to open your books and so forth and so on. So that's the thing about unincorporated association. You can also open up a bank account, get an EIN number, fill the unincorporated association and get an EIN number, and actually go to the bank and open up a trust or a bank account under that particular ministry, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that becomes a good thing to do, too. And like you said, that's different than the 501c3, which came about by Lyndon B. Johnson back in the 1965, in which that he decided on putting together this 501c3, in which that would stop churches from being political. In an unincorporated association, there is no such restriction as far as being political or so. So that means that you can also have a civic side of the organization.
Right. Right. Now, with that, ikram is not the only religious or spiritual order that does this, correct?
No,
that would operate under. There's plenty of others, and
they
use this behind.
What'd
you say?
I say they do what they do, but we'll be the best.
Right,
because my point about commenting on it is that you know this being under considered as God's people. Or being religious to the point where this is your lifestyle and it's not something that you do one day for a couple hours a week, that this is every day how you live. When you see different religious societies that, you know, go by the book, meaning their religious holy text, they, you know, are a society of, for, and by themselves. And, you know, they interact with the rest of the world, but they're very tightly knit, and they practice their spiritual way of life the way that their ancestors had practiced it. And examples of that would be, you know, the Amish, Hasidic Jews, folks that you know, you don't really see their children. You mentioned, you know, homeschooling. You don't really see their children in public or even private schools. And, you know, as adults, we don't really see too many of them in the so-called secular courtrooms because their religious leaders usually handle the internal issues that they have because that's another aspect of being a holy person, that, you know, you treat each other with a certain amount of respect. Can you comment on that as far as, you know, belonging to, you know, a spiritual ancestral practice and sticking to it, the benefits of that?
Right. Well, rituals are utilized because the left brain needs something tangible to utilize in order to tap into the right hemisphere of the brain, which deals with the abstract. So an altar is used as part of the ritual because you have your incense there, you have pictures of your ancestors that passed on, you have your candles, you have your particular books or scriptures in which that you read from at the altar. The altar itself is just like when the Christians say they come up to the altar, when you come up to the altar for prayer. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But standing there is the preacher, you know, at the altar. And he's telling everybody in the congregation about the prayer. All right. Well,
mm-hmm.
when you have your own personal altar in your house, you're going to prayer, but it's not a man in front of you. It's more so the essence of spirit of those who passed on in which that you would feel, in which that, or, you know, which actually when you utilize your altar, you transform them, you know, from dead relatives to living ancestors. And that means now they can work on your behalf. So the things in which that you want to help manifest or bring about, now you have these spirits working on your behalf in order to help open the gateway or the doorway for you. All right. Is this blasphemy? Of course not. Because Jesus believed in spirits. He referred to them as angels. But he also referred to the demonic spirits that was in Legion, which was 666 of them, in which that he took them out of Legion, in which that he cast into the pigs. So when we're talking about spirits, we're talking about angelical forces on which that can help you. These are your ancestors that have passed on, especially those who are righteous, you know, who changed your shitty-ass diapers and loved you on this physical plane.
Right.
As a matter of fact, who gave you money to help you for the education or get food in your belly so that you can survive another day on this earthly plane. They are the ones who helped you while they was here. Why wouldn't they want to help you while they're not physically here, but they are still here in the spirit? And we always hear that, you know, we're going to pour out a little bit of liquor for those who have passed on. Okay, that's an African ritual. That's called libations. So on the day, you would pour libations, you know, for those who have passed on, those who are not here, you know, but they're not physically here, but they are here spiritually. So you always want to keep that because that is still power in which that guards you and protects you and help watches over you in trying times and tribulations and certain events, negative events and, you know, in situations. You need that type of protection from your ancestors, you know, so we teach you how to do that also. So this is just another way of what we're talking about. And all of this, once again, without having to do low magic, which is actually tapping into animal rituals, which is not necessary, you know, but tapping right into the chi or prana or chi energy, the ancestral energy, which is still here, or was that it permeates what is called the realm of form, which is the ethereal plane or ethers, as we refer to it as. So we always want to be able to tap into the ethers, which deals with the communication. That's what your pineal gland is for when it's fully activated. Is the bridge or the doorway on which they give you the link from the physical into the spiritual world. And so you can receive your ancestral messages from the spiritual world via your third eye, in which that is your mind's eye. So hence, this information is embedded inside of your brain, in which that then goes into your cellular structure or cellular structure in your cells. And now you become a walking antenna for the ancestors. You know, so that's really what we want to be, because they have a broader scope than we do. You know, our third eye has a broader scope. We can actually tap into the past, present, and future. You want to be able to be activated and open like that so that you can gain insights and future references just in case if things could possibly go awry or go wrong. You have a way in order to handle the situation and actually be a magician and make things go right.
Now, as far as we talked about, you know, the daily practices that you know you must do, but getting to these levels of high spiritual and personal mastery, you know, some folks, it's very difficult for them to imagine that. What techniques can they use to, you know, well, just to imagine that for themselves to be able to get to that level? Because a lot of folks, you know, are the self is, you know, what they can see and touch and taste and hear and feel on the physical level. So moving from that into having visions and being able to sense beings within the room and being able to pick up on other folks' thoughts. For some people, mm-hmm. that is, you know, that freaks them out a bit.
Yeah.
And they don't want to believe that it's real. Some folks end up getting prescription drugs for these issues to turn them off because they don't know what to do about that. They don't know what to do about it. And, you know, if they go to, sometimes they go to the religious leaders and it's not a good, you know, it's not a good thing.
No.
All they can say is that they'll pray for them. If they go to the doctor, the psychiatrist, there's a prescription they can offer them. But it's not, you know, what we're talking about in this conversation is, you know, on an indigenous tip, is very natural. You're supposed to. You're supposed to reach these levels.
Right. But let me tell you, there's a difference between a person who does this naturally and have a good diet on which they're able to absorb through their intestine, their stomach, vitamin B complex, in particular vitamin B12. That is a person who are able to do this at a drop of a dime. A person who has a deficiency of vitamin B complex, in particular vitamin B12, they can develop what is called schizophrenia. And this is where the person go awry at, but it's nothing more than a chemical imbalance, and they and the vitamin in which they need is vitamin B12. So that's why we teach the science of a living, which is a diet, you know, as far as being able to, and also we do blood analysis. We also do irisology. So I can look in your eyes and see exactly what's going on with you in your particular organ, and, you know, and you want herbs to teach them to help rectify that matter, homeopathic product. We also do blood analysis, and it's that basically being old and AB or A blood type, you can see what your blood is deficient in under a microscope. And just in one drop of blood, we can tell if there's parasites, worms, fat deposits, cancer. And vitamin B12 deficiency, all these things can be seen under a microscope, just in one drop of blood, because that one drop of blood will tell you anything and what's going on in your entire body.
Wow.
So we do that. So this is part of the learning skills and what you can also learn and be a part of the ignorance. We will teach you these particular sciences also. So this information never stops. You become an herbalist, you learn this herbology, you learn the science of plants, how to identify in the nature. All these things begin to, you know, start becoming more holistic as you begin to start going through the training. Because actually what we're doing is the order of Mel-Chi-Zedek is actually turning you into a shaman or a shaman healer.
That's definitely, from my historical studies, that, you know, in the past, when some of our ancestors were enslaved, there was an attempt before full-on enslavement and bringing in the soldiers to, you know, convert the villagers or, you know, the people of the land to a religion that's foreign to them. That was the first, you know, so they sent in the missionaries because that's the mission, is to convert their entire way of thinking so that the resources can be, you know, confiscated or stolen.
Right.
So that was the first thing that happened is they tried to convert them from their way of thinking, from their way of honoring their ancestors and honoring themselves and communicating with one another. And before, you know, the language, before the drum and all that was taken away, and before, the, you know, the families were broken up, that was the first attempt to, you know, and they readily admit that. They readily admit that when they're teaching you about how they did it, how they, you know, things came to be the way they are in these times. But if that didn't work, then that's when the soldiers were sent in. And the first people to die, the first people to get murdered were, you know, the high priests and the high priestesses. Because that's, you know, those folks represented and just their being in their flesh, that is, that person or those people were the connection between those who walk the land and those who move about it in spirit, you know, because that's, I was, you know, telling someone the other day that concept that when someone dies, that, you know, or leaves their flesh, that they just don't exist at all in any way, shape, or form anymore, that's something very foreign to how we used to think.
Very foreign. That's because obviously, they didn't pay attention in class when they went over Newton's laws. Newton's law 101 states specifically that energy cannot be created nor destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
So where was they at in science
class?
See, that's what I'm talking about. See, they can go to school in order to get a goddamn grade, an A-plus grade for a European system and for a Albion male or female as they're teaching. They would strive hard to get an A. But when it comes to common sense for their own self and being melanated beings, it seems that they can't think a damn lick. And they come up with all these accusations that the European told them the totality of the whole universe is that energy cannot be created nor destroyed. Now, is your physical body governed by energy? The answer is yes. Quite simple.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever they believe, is really silly for a melanated being to believe. But if that's what they believe, then guess what? They're incarnated in order to learn the shit over again in order to find out for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That's
right.
One of the individuals who will have to incarnate again because they didn't quite master this third dimension in order to gain lift off. They want to be able to come back, so they come up with all these ridiculousness, you know, of saying crazy-ass answers like that. So, you know, we can see them coming back again. That's no problem. Some people will have to come back. But as far as the question says, them coming after the high priest, well, that's why the high priest and high priestess also must be spiritual warriors.
Right.
Not just spiritual warriors, but also warriors themselves. So they must learn martial art. They must learn
exactly
different hands-on healing techniques, just in case of, and also, you know, nursing, medical field type
right.
of apparatuses for survival. You must learn herbology or herbalism, as he said earlier, to be able to identify the herbs in order to eat, just in case of, you know, in other words, all survival mechanisms. They must learn, like I said earlier, archery. They must learn shooting as far as gun shooting, weaponry. They must learn martial arts. They must learn all these different aspects of, you know, as being high priest and high priestess. You can't be high if you never learned how to get low, you know. So, you know, we must learn how to master all of these aspects. So the science is that we must be spiritual warriors. So, yes, the spirit, we deal with that aspect, but we also must be warriors and deal with that aspect. That's the whole thing about Mark, who symbolizes the highest self. And Sutek symbolizes the lowest self. Sutek is that. This is symbolic to the lowest self. Marku, which is Mayach, the mother of virtue, symbolizes the higher self. So we must be spiritual warriors. And so we must combine both. Remember that red and that white crown. That means that we must master the lower self as well as also the higher self. That way, there's not going to be much of a battle.
All right. that, and that goes into the whole point of that. We're speaking basically about the culture clash, where, you know, within Ikhwan, it is expected that your higher senses will be developed, but in Western society, it's considered, you know, you're crazy, you're psychotic.
Right.
Within Ikhwan, it's in indigenous societies, in aboriginal societies all over the world, it's expected for you to maintain that connection you have with your ancestors and to be a living representative of them in the flesh.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And not only for them, but everything you do will go towards, you know, your legacy that you leave for your children and your children's children.
Right.
So on that point, you know, because, you know, that ancestral connection gets a lot of criticism. However, 2 days ago, what was it? Memorial Day for a lot of people.
Exactly.
Memorial Day.
Exactly.
They are celebrating fallen, the dead, you know, dead soldiers on one. And okay, yes, that's very honorable. But at the same time, when we do it, it's incorrect and it's backward and it's wrong. But whatever, when they do it, it's you know, everybody gets off that day. And, you have to pay homage to all of these folks that you don't even know.
Right.
But to pay homage to folks
right,
actually.
You go, right, to pay homage to the people who have passed on your behalf now, who in a sense,
yeah,
died
exactly.
For you. And then you give them.
If they were paid to die, that's one thing, right?
Right, they paid to die for you, right? But then you go and grill and you do animal sacrifices on their behalf.
Right. Right. Exactly, right? That's what the feasting is about, right? The cooking
mm-hmm.
out.
Right.
Grilling that day.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that's the sacrifice that is taking place on behalf of them, but yet you're not putting two and two together. So here we are telling you what this really is, and then you're doing the thing without knowing what you're really doing. Which one has more science?
Right. Now, in response to that, too, you're talking about being a spiritual warrior. That day, instead of grilling, you know, the animals, sacrificing the animals, like you're saying, and just, you know, doing the normal things that people do on that day, you know, we got together in the Philadelphia area. We got together in the park. A few of us went out in the park, and we were listening to tribal, you know, East African music.
Mm-hmm.
And we were banging away on our drums, and we was chanting in, you know, Kamishan and Nuwabic, sacred divine words. This is what we did. Brothers and sisters, they were doing their practicing, you know, their sparring with the martial arts. And then, I mean, we had our fresh cut fruit. The children were out there playing and running around, you know, and we were sitting outside, you know, between the trees, a bunch of us. And then at the end of the day, we did an ancestor ceremony. And it was very powerful. It was very powerful. You know, we have within ICRM, there's a lot that can be done. There's a lot that can be done with the guidance of the ancestors, especially the sisters that came, you know, made that point with them. You know, a lot of folks on that day are celebrating, you know, remembering those that they've lost to the other side. And, you know, with ICRM, on a day like that, we are remembering those that we have gained on the other side, because, you know, transcendence of the flesh is no easy task.
No, it's not.
And to leave it and to be able to be an ancestor is a gift. To be able to, you know, guide others along the way, that's, you know, within that position, to be in that position, to live your life, you know, holistically, and to be honorable and noble, and to be called upon and to be honored, that's huge. And that's not something that just, you know, Aboriginal folks do. There's folks,
right,
you know, in Asia that do it regularly. They send that ancestor money habitually. It's, you know, it's a part of their duties as a living person that breathes air. If you breathe air, you know, there's a reason for that. And those that came before you, you know, that unbroken line that goes way back, you know, as far back as eternity, that they, you know, unbroken line of male, female relations that produce life.
Mm-hmm.
To move forward into the future. That's something that, you know, the ancestors, they set up a lot of things just to honor that aspect alone. With the Ankh, you know, the symbolism there. And, you know, the Hinduism honoring the family and the relationship between male and female and, you know, with marriage, husband and wife. All of the god entities are married to goddesses, maintaining that balance. And producing
mm-hmm.
children. You have a
exactly.
Prince
Angel
on the line?
Yep, I'm here.
Huh? We're here,
we're here.
Just hearing you out, sister.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yes.
Oh, you
that,
was asking
oh, we, yeah, we did that. We did that the other day.
Oh, no. That's what I'm saying. You was asking me that question.
Yes.
Okay, ask me one more time.
No, I'm saying that's what I was telling you. No, that's what we did the other day.
Right.
On that day. It was
right,
very warm outside, you know.
On
we didn't want to be
day.
Inside.
Right.
Not want to be inside all day. That's something that we're going to add to this ritual book that we're putting together, that I'm putting together
for the
initiates. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Oh, wait, well,
you know,
let's speak about that. I mean, that's something else that we need to speak about. And you made mention of the fact of the ritual book. Tell us some things in which that is the concepts behind the ritual book and, or the development of an actual culture, because that's actually what this is, you know, really doing. Tell us about that.
Well, we've been performing rituals for every new moon, full moon, solstice, and equinox, and other very, very holy days since the night of Asherah, which is a very holy day amongst many religions, the last one late last year. And moving in this energy... Very, you know, you're sticking to nature, basically,
right.
And understanding how that works. Because there's different levels to being, you know, in a priesthood, especially one that follows nature, where you have to, you know, maintain your physical clarity, meaning, you know, constantly cleansing and providing nutrients to yourself. And working with nature, you know, with the rays of the sun and the earth and the moon moving at all times. There's different vibrations that come to the planet and affects all of us. So to honor these changes in these frequencies, there's certain times where they're very, very potent, and there's things that you should do and can do to take advantage of that within your life. It affects, you know, each of us as we are manifested in the flesh. We come here at different times, different months, to, you know, different manifestations, and so the energy that comes to the planet, you know, it's all coming from the sun, it's all coming from the moon,
mm-hmm.
it's emanating from the earth, it's coming from these different planets that, you know, are moving along right along with us, coming from these different stars, but because we all come in individually on different times, or at different times in different locations, it affects us specifically, just, you know, a tad bit different, but there are some generalizations. So the rituals that are going to be a part of this ritual book will help each of us to better understand how to move along. Because, for instance, tonight is the new moon in Gemini, and that has a lot to do with, you know, not just talking about it, but being about it.
Mm-hmm.
And Gemini, you know, that's the one that communicates, great communicator, being able to see things from all different angles. But in this essence, with it being in a new moon, with a new moon being, you know, just dwelling within this Gemini energy, has a lot to do with making sure that we don't see things for what we want them to be, but to see them as they actually are. So, you know, just that lesson alone, just that lesson alone, there's, you know, there's a lot that, that goes into that. And there's certain things that, you know, will be shown at this point. Being that, you know, again, the new moon in Gemini, that means that, you know, liars and deceivers are actually going to be pulled out. Because, you know, not just the new moon in Gemini, but you have that, you know, that grand cardinal cross still, you know, still in effect. You know, at some points, the degrees that make it up are, you know, more direct than others, but it's still out there. And this is, you know, something that our ancestors used to do. They watched the stars.
Mm-hmm.
They watched the stars and they made decisions based on the movement. And a lot, you know, the holy books have a lot of information as far as, you know, being able to not just, you know, be in the flesh and, you know, do what your personal mission is upon the planet, but to also understand nature. Understand nature on a level that you are not just the subject of it, but you can actually benefit from it. More than just being able to, you know when to harvest the food and know when to plant the food and know when to sow and when to reap, but also being able to understand the psychology of people. That is also something that you'll get from this ritual book because, you know, once you're initiated, because if you're not into astrology, you're not into numerology, and you don't study psychology or sociology on any level, once you do, you'll be able to tell, you know, what's going on around your social environment a little bit better, being able to understand why folks behave the way that they do as individuals, and then at certain times of the month, you know, with the full moon and with the new moon. Right now we are approaching the summer solstice. The summer, you know, just to be able to understand what does that mean.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? We are approaching the summer solstice on a scientific level. That means that, you know, our days are still getting longer. Our days
mm-hmm.
are still getting longer. There's more light within the day. The summer solstice happens to be the day of the year where we have the most light. We have
mm-hmm.
the most light. And then that goes into how do you observe that? What should you do? What shouldn't you do? Because, you know, I also do the numerology reading, that tells you, you know, in your personal life, when is it a good time to buy a house? When is it a good time to, you know, take care of domestic issues? Well, it depends on when you came here to this planet and what cycle within your life are you in? Where are you? You know, because there's certain things that you can do as a baby that you can't possibly do as an adult, and vice versa. You know, just on that. Just
mm-hmm.
on that natural level. Because, you know, a very basic understanding is, you know, when the moon comes out and the sun's not here, that means you should be, you know, in home. It's dark outside, you should go to sleep. During the daytime, it's light time, you should be doing your work, your day's work. This understanding of the cosmos goes much further than that. You know, as far as when to have children, when to have your mates, we'll give you insight about that because there's a lot of chaos that occurs in folks' lives due to the fact that they don't understand this and they lack the knowledge or they think that it means, you know, nothing, but the ancestors have left too many relics to tell you otherwise, way too many relics all over the globe, you know, that are in alignment with different stars, that, you know, when the sun hits it at a certain point, lights up the whole, you know, the building. So, you know, if it works, you know, if it works, and they're not, you know, in the flesh, on a certain aspect, you can say they're not here anymore. Although, you know, they live within their descendants. Some of those powers are latent within us, and once you know, one of the ways to awaken that is to become a part of IC.G.R.O.M. and to do the practices, Prince Aline mentioned earlier, to awaken oneself and to, you know, really learn to relinquish the understanding of itself as being the physical body. That's, you know, one of the reasons why a person would be able to go through several different religious houses and, you know, become initiated in them is because they can see the commonalities within them in the first place. A lot of, you know, the esoteric and Gnostic teachings, that's one of the principles, is that you are not your body.
Mm-hmm.
You are not your body. So then what am I? Well, you have to study yourself. Okay, well, you have to study yourself on a very natural level, so you have to study nature.
Right.
You have to study nature. If you don't study nature and you just watch television or just, you know, just entertained all day, and that's, you know, we were talking earlier about those common distractions, then, you know, trying to grasp why someone behaves the way they do or why you're in the current situation or where are you going to be in 10 years, you could do that.
Mm-hmm.
You could do that. And at this point, there's so much energy coming in. I'm encountering folks that are able to, you know, have visions of things that are going on without even having to meditate. So this is, you know, affecting us. And the other thing is, too, that within the, you know, mainstream media, this is being heavily promoted. You know, you have television shows about folks, you know, turning on these superpowers and using mm-hmm. them, using them, basically. I know there's a lot of cartoons and anime where, you know, they're talking about the chakras, they're talking about the chi and powering up. And, you know, using their craft and, you know, understanding how to use their aura and crystals. So, you know, now it's more, and also not only that, but with metaphysics coming into play, New Age and Tantra, the more commercial sides of it, you know, folks will understand. But there have always been deeper meanings to all of this. And there, you know, if you read a lot of these holy books for yourself, you'll see that, you know, the story of the three wise men. If the three wise men, they look into the sky to understand when the Savior is coming. You know, and, you know, there's a lot of folks that say, oh, well, you know, studying astrology is wrong. Well, there's that, and then, you know, there's a book in the Quran where it's about the zodiac,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yes.
Right.
And, you know, you don't study numerology. Well, in the Bible, there's a book called Numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Really, exactly. You know, it's like you don't have to be, you know, a super saiyan or nothing like that to really put one and one together to comprehend what they're telling you. And then, you know, one of the religions that I really like is Buddhism, because that's it's really not a religion. That's a way of life. In the West, you know, these systems, it's easier to use them and misuse them according to how we've been trained to practice them. But, you know, with these esoteric studies, it's much more difficult to get away from the main point of, you know, finding oneself and learning how to meditate or visualize or, you know, do your affirmations and morning rituals. Whereas even just, you know, the word ritual scares a person because, you know, this is a ritual book. The word ritual scares you. Then consider how you wake up in the morning. You may take your shower,
mm-hmm.
brush your teeth. You may wash your face. You may, you know, get dressed, you know, iron your clothes and get dressed. You may kiss the husband or the wife and the children goodbye and go to work. for the next 8 or 9 or 12 hours and then come back home, expect to eat dinner, and you're going to do this tomorrow, the day after that, and then you take a break, as you do every Saturday and Sunday. And then Monday you start. That's a ritual. That is a ritual. And, you know, you may not do it with an altar, right? You may not do it with an altar. You may not do it with, you know, prayers, but that, you know, the consistency. The consistency and the ceremonial aspects of that are for real.
Oh, yeah.
They are for real. Within this also, we'll be putting some information about the indigenous language because, you know, being able to speak in your own tongue is very important as well. But in general, this ritual book will present ideas on how to capitalize on natural energies when they come in. When is it a good time to, you know, work on specific projects, especially if you want to be successful?
Right.
Especially if you want to be successful, you know, as even in business. Even in business, there's ways to use this energy so that it's not basically so that you don't fail. The chances of failure are lessened, and you know, truly successful people, you know, have a habit of getting up very early in the morning. Very early in the morning to get their things done. And especially, you know, very spiritual people get up as early as 3 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And done all work by noon. Where most people have a ritual of, you know, being at work by 8 or 9 and getting done by 5. That is a ritual. It is a national, you know, a national ritual within the U.S. And that's something, you know, that goes without question. And there, you know, those holy days, you know, that they observe without really looking into it and, you know, how destructive it is, that, you know, not just to your pocket because you have, you know, you're expected to do certain things whether you've been initiated into these religions or not, but the widespread expectation that you will participate. You will participate in those, you know, days that they tell you to observe without question. And, you know, you get pressure from your family and all of that. So this is not that. This is a very, you know, individual approach to making sure that, you know, the household is protected, that you are divinely protected, that you're honoring your ancestors, that, you know, you're settling your karmic debt. That's another, you know, natural aspect of just being alive and breathing, is to settle those debts. And it's very direct and very clear. There's no, you know, secrecy in that because, you know, we need more. The world needs to be stuff. The aspects of, you know, personal karma, cultural karma, national karma has got to be cleared up.
Yeah, definitely. Yes, most definitely. Because before we go bankrupt on that, on those aspects
right.
You just spoke of, you know.
Right. You talk about bankrupt. There's actually, I mentioned before, the ancestor money. I mentioned the ancestor money. That is a Taoist tradition, and we use that within, well, I use that within the ancestor rituals where folks can actually send their folks money on the other side. They can send in this spiritual money. In this Taoist tradition where you send this ancestor money, it has the Jade Emperor, which in Taoism is reported to be the king of heaven. They send their ancestors $10,000 bills, $1 million bills, $50 billion bills, $80 trillion bills, and bigger, right? This is, they send, and they, you know, how they have origami, clothes, shoes, watches, cars, televisions, rugs, pots of gold. They send this. This is, you know, these are adults that do this on the regular. It is a natural custom in Taoism to do that. And you see how they live, though. in the flesh, these folks are living lavishly. Whereas, you know, folks, you know, on average, folks that don't aren't living, you know, on that level. And here's the other thing, too. When you go to the store and you try to buy those bills for your ancestors, you can only get maybe the $10,000 bill increments. This is how serious it is.
Wow.
You know, or how serious it is. You can't just walk up, well, not locally where I'm at, you can't just walk up in a store and say, you know, well, I want a million, give me like $5 million stacks for my ancestors. You can't do that because they keep it for themselves. And they only sell those amongst themselves. So, you know, believe, oh, well, you know, ancestors, I don't know about that. You know, I've been, you know, I've had folks from older generations that, you know, were alive in the 60s that they have this feeling that the Black Pride era was just a fad and that it didn't work out for us very well. So any type of, you know, Africanity or any type of paying homage to these folks in history that appear to, you know, have been advertised as the losers, why should we, you know, give them any attention whatsoever?
Right.
We have that as well. So with observing, you know, is the birthdays or the holy days or the days that they transition, that's our way of maintaining the connection with our ancestors. And it's a very healing aspect, too. There's a lot that goes into that as far as, you know, those who are in the flesh to remember their loved ones that have transcended. It's better to, for a lot of us, to really maintain that connection instead of trying to bury feelings of not having those people here anymore as well. But that's what the ritual book will have within it. Ceremonies, how to get back into your indigenous and aboriginal practices, spiritually and practically, in ways that can help you, you know, in your daily life. That's what the book is about.
Okay. Yeah. Yes, a lot of that, what you spoke of, yes, we need a lot of that, you know. And the key factor is with most Moors coming into those kinds of sciences is that they, and I say again, that they need to be ready spiritually, mentally, and emotionally for that, you know. And as long as they study the self, study themselves, and basically the more they come to their higher self, and when they get to the higher self, that's the more they'd be ready for it, you know. Eating right, eating the right type of foods.
Right.
Dealing with spiritually and mentally as well as physically, you know. And taking in the kind of foods in your mind and spirit and as
mm-hmm.
well. And therefore you'd be more ready for the initiation. It's going to come forth
right.
on the 28th of June, you know.
Right.
And if you don't have any, and for people that doesn't have any kind of insight on what we are talking about tonight, well, they might run into some difficulties. Or
right.
they leave unsatisfied. Or, oh, man, I didn't learn nothing. You know, I thought this was going to be, well... You know, it's not that. It's just that you won't allow yourself to accept or to bring in a lot of this science into you because you're still stuck on, you know, what you believe in religiously. So you might say, oh, that contradicts what against what I read in the Bible or what I read in the Quran. What I read in the Zend Avestas or what I read in the Bhagavad Gita, you know, or
mm-hmm.
so on and so on, you know. And what they all fail to realize, they all come from the same schools. from the
right.
Moorish Kemetic temples, you know, in ancient times.
Right.
And, you know, it's like this. If you can't get them to see what the basic principles that they are not black, Negro, colored, Ethiopian, African-American, people of color, so on and so on, but then there's
mm-hmm.
no need to go on no further else with them. Because anything else you
right.
try to bring to them, it just won't. It's not going to register, you know.
Right, and that's a commitment to be against it. Those that folks that are, you know, anti-Indigenous, anti-Aboriginal, anti-Moorish, that
mm-hmm.
is a commitment. That is
yeah.
a commitment to not see things any other way than the way that they want to see it.
Right.
But, you know, as I talked about the other day, how we were out at the park, and some of those sisters, they had never done that before. And
right.
I'm not sure if the brothers, you know, the brothers over there, I know two of them probably have, but one, he may not have ever done that before. So it was a little bit difficult, you know, to get in tune with the drum. To get
mm-hmm.
in tune with the drum, you know, and I mentioned to them, you know, we are melanated folk. This
right.
is ours. You know, you should be no embarrassment, no shame. This is your drum. Work it. You
right.
know, you have to
right.
get into it just to be able to make, you know, to be able to make a beat. That's something that's unique, you know, with hip hop traveling the way that it has in just a very short amount of time. There are folks that, you know, genetically would have had great difficulty in making a beat that
yeah.
can do it with much, you know, with much ease now just because of how hard the bass thumps when they hear something, you know, hip-hop. So, you know, but being able to play, you know, a drum set is quite different from, you know, your hands and palms touching the natural elements, you know, of, you know, some type of animal skin and wood, and you're actually, you know, responsible for keeping a beat amongst a crowd of people.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So just that aspect alone, you know, just being able to get in tune in that way, you know, the metaphysics, the meditation, affirmations and all of that, but to feel that, you know, going to school, Western schooling, for Africans, African descendants, that's in many ways it tears us away from our culture.
Yes.
And it makes us feel negatively about our ancestors
mm-hmm.
and our ancestral practices. The drum, though, that's, you know, everybody likes the drum, but to get on it, it's not so easy.
Right.
And to, like I said, to make a beat and to be harmonious with others, I had to, you know, and I definitely want to do that again. We all had a great time. It was wonderful. It's just, you know, whenever you get with folks and you want to just immediately just make some harmony, you have to get through, well, how do I feel about myself and what is this person doing over here? You know, looking at each other as strangers. That's a Western.
Yes.
That's a very Western, you know.
Yeah, so they instead of embracing
where,
each other as family, you know.
Right. This is a person that I don't know yet. This is a friend that I don't know yet. Whereas, you know, Western society is basically built, you know, and especially right now with all the, you know, the revolutionary concepts that are passed around through, you know, all the different types of folks that are here now, all the different belief systems that are political, right?
Right.
It's, you know, to try and to communicate and to harmonize, we have to get through a lot of, you know, how we feel about our personal selves. So with this, you know, now this push of the Aboriginal mind state, an Aboriginal consciousness overall and in general, that is being introduced now. I think that, you know, the rights of indigenous people, that document by the UN has a lot to do with that. But then at the same time, we're in a new age where that brotherhood is you know, supposed to come back. So, you know, being able to connect with each other in this way,
mm-hmm.
On a personal, human level, that that is a science that is very unique to Aboriginals and Indigenous folk.
Mm-hmm.
Was just watching one of the Moors talk about when, you know, supposedly when Columbus came over. In his own diaries, he talked about how he was greeted by about 2,000 Aboriginals.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't really happen. When would that, when they gave him food, shelter, clothing, gifts, him and his crew? And in exchange, what did they get?
they got death, you know.
Right.
They got smallpox and venereal diseases and the like, you know, in return. You know, I had one sister tell me today that actually Columbus was lost. You know,
mm-hmm.
to discover anything, you know, he was lost. And, you know, it was already discovered long, you know, before he came on the scene, you know.
And, right.
And like you said, what did they get for their hospitality when the man did arrive, you know?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of strife and backstabbings and murders and, you know, you name it, you know.
Right.
You know, every kind of low-life thing they could do to the people to wipe them out, you know.
Mm-hmm. And that mentality has taken over, the raping,
yeah.
murdering, stealing, lying. That's
yeah.
not a divine. None of those things are coming from a divine mindset.
No, come from a twisted mindset, you know.
Right.
From people that are criminally insane, you know.
Right.
And so it's the saddest part about it, those are the people that's ruling the world, you know, by criminally insane,
right.
twisted-minded people, you know. And
right.
That's the sad part about it.
Right. And what is it, in ancient times, the pharaohs and a lot of leaders within the different global nations in ancient times, you had to be a son or a daughter of the divine to be considered eligible to rule.
Uh-huh.
You couldn't just be, you know, an avatrician that just, you know, tries to be a good person. That they can't. It's convenient. You had to be truly divine, and it had to be proven. You had to be able to heal other
right.
people. You had to, you know, be able to do that service, which is very important. You had to be able to protect folks with your intelligence, and you had to be able to nourish folks as well.
Right.
You know? And with I.C.G.R.O.M, it just seems like that is what we are, that's our, you know, what the motto of knowing thyself is important, so that, you know, you make sure that you check your behaviors by what, you know, should be in your heart. So
mm-hmm.
not just about trying to be a good person when you can or when it's convenient, but, you know, it's like the prince said, adhering to very high moral standards, staying true to your mission, why you were sent here in the first place, and continuously raising your frequency.
Mm-hmm.
That is, you know, part of the work of I.C.G.R.O.M and helping other folks to do the same. Because, again, you know, you have the ancestors that were enslaved. Some of us had our ancestors enslaved, but even before that, you have some very powerful folks,
exactly.
you know, in the bloodline. Very powerful folk. And, you know, what's going on now is just a shame.
It is. It is. It's really deplorable.
To say the least, that is, you know, for folks to even, you know, some of it, obviously, that we hear propaganda and advertisements of the Negro just being a Negro.
Right.
Just being a Negro and just, you know, but that's not God's creation. That's not the divine's or Allah's creation.
No.
That is some man's creation.
No doubt.
Right. That's not God's creation at all. That is, you know, a divine creation being buried under false intelligence. You know, looking external or looking to the external to fulfill, you know, questions of who am I, where am I, what am I supposed to be doing with my life.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the motto of, you know, I should know myself and then I'll know the universe and God. There's so many levels to that. It's a very
ancient.
Yeah, there's so many levels to that, just on a practical level and, you know, mystic level and a esoteric level. You know, and there's lots of books written. There's
mm-hmm.
lots of books written on that. You know, I definitely, you know, thinking to add the natural laws in there because they get referred to a lot, but we don't go through them enough, those hermetic laws or the, you know, the ways of thinking of along the lines of Tahuti where, you know, through experience you're supposed to gain wisdom. That
right.
doesn't happen either. That doesn't happen either. Just, you know, the basic ways of, you know, because some folks are atheists.
Yeah.
Some folks are atheists and they don't believe in, you know, a supreme God in the way that the mainstream is, you know, they hold that. Or even in any, you know, I guess non-mainstream where, you know, religion is practiced as a, you know, ritualistically daily type of observance. Some folks are agnostic and atheists where they just don't believe that, but then at the same time they still have morals, most of them.
Yeah, they
still
do.
Have morals. They still have principles of humanity that they abide by. They still wake up, you know, I was watching David Wynn Miller. He was saying, you know, you're an atheist. You still wake up in the morning and say to yourself, when you look in the mirror, that you say, I believe in myself.
Right.
And you treat others the way that you want to be treated. So
exactly.
You can't get hung up. You can't even get hung up on that word. You have to, you know, in these times, you got to go into deeper meanings and fuller explanations of, you know, well, what do you mean by that when you say that? Does that mean that you're just going to go around and, you know, rape everyone and murder everyone and just, you know, cussing everybody out?
Right.
No, the atheists tend to not do that. But those that consider themselves to be religious do it all the time.
Oh, most definitely, you know. The Christian institution has more blood on their hand than any other religious institution on the planet. And just read
right.
them and just look at their history. And, you know, in the name of God or the name of Jesus, you know.
Right. Exactly. Right. In the name of all these other folks, they, you know, don't have the experience of ever meeting or coming to terms with their deeper under, you know, their deeper understanding or comprehension. You know, that's, again, knowledge of oneself. To be able to comprehend yourself, that's the only way you're going to be able to understand other people.
Right.
Truly and really. So these practices we're talking about with the pranayama yoga and the pranic healing, the tai chi and the qigong, they really assist you because you're forced, in all of these practices, you really are forced, even yoga, you're forced to slow down.
Right.
You know, everything is so fast-paced over here. You're forced to slow down and breathe, which, you know, is another just daily inhaling, exhaling is a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have a lot of asthmatics, a lot of folks that are depressed. You know, those rates are really high. And in some cases, they are the highest they've ever been in the, you know, at this time right now. These mental diseases and disorders are running rampant.
Right.
Partly because of, you know, we mentioned earlier, partly because of, you know, the lack of nutrition and the false information about, you know, being healthy. What does that mean,
mm-hmm.
that you're healthy? You know, because for a lot of us, that means that, you know, the doctor has no need to give us any prescriptions.
No,
that
she doesn't.
Mean that you're healthy, necessarily. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the only reason you even go for a psychiatric analysis is if you've done some harm to someone else, or, you know, it's considered that you may do some harm very, you know, in the near future to yourself.
Right.
So with this, you know, with becoming initiated within ICRM, you are able to provide pastoral counseling for people, you know, within your cipher of influence or your circle of influence, according to their belief system. Because that, you know, going back to that divine law and, you know, spiritual practices and religious practices and doing what works for you as an individual is very important. And I've read up on that in certain places in Africa where you have the village, right? You have the village chief and the village divine entity that's, you know, supposed to protect the villagers, but then each villager within their home, they have a family deity. And then each person that lives within each of those, you know, each room of those homes, they have someone, you know, specifically that they deal with,
right,
to help guide them throughout their life. You know, and in Native America, that was in many ways the different animal spirits that would come, the totems, right?
Mm-hmm.
And within, but you know, within Western society, that's not really, you know, you're supposed to just give that up. That cultural clash, whenever it clashes, it seems you have to give up your own way. If you're an Aboriginal or Indigenous or Native of any land, you're supposed to give that up for some form of European thinking. It's
right.
It's always canceled out.
Right.
You must make that choice, correct?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. In order to fit in, you know. Or else,
right,
you consider a subversive. You know,
right.
Unwilling to conform. You know, you want to give up your culture. You don't want to give up your culture. You don't want to give up your language, your heritage, your history, your birthright, your nationality. What's wrong with you? You know. Yeah, you know. That's why we are doing what we're doing today, you know, getting our Aboriginal and Indigenous culture back, our nationality and our birthright back, you know, and our free national names back, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, this is all the process of what we are doing here in North America and all over the world as Aboriginal and Indigenous Moors.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a hard to tell people that they're, even some of your most intellectuals, what you call enlightened Moors, you know, a lot of them still want to cling on that they are black, you know, which is to my surprise, you know, they still cling on to the black status, or people of color status, or African-American status, you know. They want to still cling on to that. It's hard for them to give up and come to the word toward the meaning Moor or Asiatic, you
right.
know, or Aboriginal Indigenous, you know. I don't know why it is that, you know, but these are, but I find that very, not only shocking, but what you say, fantastic.
Right.
I know they had to listen to us a lot of times, you know, and you explain it to them piece by piece and by piece, and they still want to be called black or African American, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I, you know, those are the people that I imagine you're going to see down there at the Sweat Lodge and down there at the initiation, you know. I'm sure you're going to see them down there. But they're not going to get the full benefit you know, if they don't change, you know, if they don't change quick.
Right.
Then
that,
I see
that,
it, that a lot of that, what they offer, like I said before, is not going to allow them to.
Mm-hmm.
Not going to let them.
Well, yeah, that has, that may have a lot to do with, you know, in English, one word has several meanings, which tells you, it tells you a lot. And then, you know, because it's so not a true, it doesn't
right.
have, you know, it's, or it's not an original language, it,
yeah.
You know, you, not only does one word have several meanings, but it can mean one thing to one person and something totally different to somebody else.
Exactly. You know, I had a lady today, she sneezed, and everybody said, bless you, bless you. I didn't say it. They said, hey, you being rude. You didn't say bless me. I said, no. I explained it a little later when everybody, well, most of the people leave, you know, what why I didn't say that. Use that term. I said, well, you know, it means, if I said that, that means you to shed blood. And she said, what? I said, yeah, that means you to shed blood.
Mm.
You know, and that's why I don't use the term, you know. But she said she was a little girl. She never did understood why that I had to be blessed because I sneezed. You know, all I'm doing, my body is doing, is rejecting certain toxins that's into my system. And I said, yeah, you're right. You're right, that's all it is, you know. So she said, why do I have to be blessed for that? You know, so that you never could understand, no way. You know, so well, what is she asking? What did you learn that from? I said, from, you can get you any etymology dictionary, and they'll tell you where the word came from.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. And she said, wow, okay, you know, I didn't know that. You know, I said, yeah. I explained to her I wasn't being rude or nothing like that. You know, but
right.
I just, you know, explained to her why.
But even that, to think, you know, to have to think, that's awkward for a lot of people, to have to think
mm-hmm.
beyond the daily routine that is their ritual.
Yeah.
That they don't have to put them, you know, and that. That's what ends up happening with rituals is that you do it without thinking. You know,
mm-hmm.
you practice it so much that you don't think about where it comes from, and especially in those instances, where it comes from. It's just, it's common, it's normal.
Mm-hmm.
But it may not be healthy. It may not serve you as a person or a man or a woman or a human being. It may not serve you, you know, throughout your life stages. It's just something that people do, and that's what we do, so we'll just, that's what we do. So why, you know, a lot of folks are like, why question it, and why, you know, get into it, explain it, and, you know, it just doesn't, it doesn't mean anything. A lot of folks there are very comfortable with no meaning.
Yes.
You know, doing things without any type of comprehension of what it actually means.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, about that is, When you say that, you are, you know, going against ages and ages and ages of symbology.
Uh-huh.
You know, the symbols that we use on a daily basis, that's going through, past and beyond your conscious mind and your, you know, just being able to pay attention to your surroundings. That's going into your subconscious and unconscious and ancestral mindset.
Uh-huh.
So with meditation, that helps to awaken that just on your conscious awareness that you have that part of you that exists.
Right.
So to say, you know, to have to, you know, you got to explain, like you said, you got to explain to the woman what that actually means. For a lot of folks, the response was just been like, oh, okay. And it's, you know,
yeah.
I mean, a good portion of people would be like, well, I'm never going to say bless you ever again.
Yeah, they take a negative, you know, approach to it, you know.
Right, I mean, but some folks will just be like, you know, well, okay, well, that, I didn't know that. I'm not going to do that anymore. I'll make a conscious decision that I'm going to live a little bit more wisely.
Yeah, that was her reaction. That was her reaction.
Right.
Yeah, you know, and I was really surprised. That was her reaction. I said, oh, okay. She said, wow.
Right.
You know, so I'm going to, what you say that is? Etymology dictionary. And I spelled it out for her. She said, okay, I'm going to look that up, you know.
Right.
Yeah, I never heard that before. And she was really interested in learning, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, you know, the kind of people you really, you know, really need, you know.
Right.
To learn, you know, and the more you learn about yourself, the more you really improve yourself. That's the real self-improvement, you know.
Right.
That a lot of people talk about, you know. And learning, self-understanding, learning to understand self and to study self, you know. And then you can learn how to deal with others. But the self is
right.
The first thing you need to deal with. You know,
right.
If you can't deal with the self, then, well, there's no need in going talking about anyone else.
Exactly. You don't understand oneself. Being able to criticize others and, you know, not being able to understand or comprehend them or have a full opinion,
mm-hmm.
not just of what you think they're doing, but to understand and comprehend them within their mindset, what they
right.
think about what it is that they're doing.
Right.
That's a skill that you have to have or you have to gain in maturity with ICHRM because, you know, being able to help folks remedy, you know, certain issues that they have
mm-hmm.
or problems or health issues, you have to, within ICHRM, we look at that from a holistic point of view.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just, you know, the diet. It's also what you do on a regular everyday basis.
Right.
You know, what are the stressors? You know,
yeah.
more than just, okay, it's allergy season, so this is why, you know, your asthma, your hay fever is acting up, but you also got in an argument with your spouse that day.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that's what, you know, you had emotional triggers. You know.
Right.
Aleem
always say, you know, stress on breathing techniques. You know,
mm-hmm.
you know, learn how to breathe and stuff like that. Meditation, which is a lot more important also sometimes, well, than fasting and whatever, you know, how to clean out your body. But the breathing techniques are very important, as he stressed, and which they are, you know, to breathe out all those toxic, you know, that's in your body, you know.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't learn the proper breathing. Yeah.
Right, with that. So for those that come at the event next month on June 28th and 29th, you will be learning about various different breathing techniques, more than just, you know, breathing from the diaphragm and breathing from, you know, from your belly button. For a lot of people, just learning about breathing from the belly button
mm-hmm.
is like, that's big news. You know, and it helps them a lot because they're used to, you know, a lot of folks are used to breathing from their shoulders or from the upper chest where it raises and falls with every single inhalation and exhalation. But, you know, finding out about breathing from the belly button, for a lot of folks, you know, that is big news.
Mm-hmm.
But you learn, there's more to learn than just that. That's
right.
just, you know, how that's a breathing technique that helps to clear your mind. But there's other techniques beyond that, well beyond that, that help to alleviate stress and headaches, migraine headaches, that, you know, if you feel like you've been poisoned, whether it's food poisoning or, you know, emotional poisoning, because, you know, certain emotions, they trigger your endocrine system to release certain secretions
mm-hmm.
that, you know, if your body is soaked in these certain secretions for a long period of time, it has adverse reactions on your emotional state that
mm-hmm.
can, you know, trigger you to behave in a way that's unbecoming.
Right.
So, yeah, there's more than just breathing from the belly button. There's, you know, certain ways that when you wake up in the morning, the Hindu system, they have, you know, good understanding of that. Of, you know, when you wake up in the morning, if a certain side of your nostril is clogged, then you should really just stay in bed until you get that fixed.
Mm-hmm.
You should really breathe a certain way because that, you know, that has an effect on your whole being, on, you know, what you're attracting and repelling within your aura. you know, the type of the energy and mood that you'll have just based off of your breathing.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's one thing that they'll definitely get next month. And with the different yoga positions and sun salutations as well. That is what we'll be doing, some of the things. And also he mentioned about the sweat lodge again. That I've only ever had powerful experiences with doing the sweat lodge.
Mm-hmm.
That is a very, very indigenous thing to be able to do. It's a very cleansing. It has a very cleansing effect on the body, the mind, the soul, and the spirit because it gets deep. You know, mm-hmm. Deeply hidden toxins or deeply embedded toxins to be released. And it helps to clean out your sweat glands as well because that, you know, having glandular dysfunctions, that's something that's on the rise as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, having issues with, you know, toxins just being stuck and just not being released. That,
yeah.
You know, and in a lot of ways, the glands are like the middleman.
Right.
So being able to get released thoroughly with, you know, with the skin from, and I'm telling you, with the sweat lodge, you're sweating from everywhere.
Yeah, that's what I heard. I haven't been in one, but that's what I heard, though.
I do me everywhere. So coming with the bathing suit.
Wow.
And make sure you drink. I'm telling you. Drinking from, you know, sweating from everywhere. You got to drink your water the day before so you have something to sweat out, you know. If you have the water in your system, then the toxins have, you know, that the water becomes a carrier to bring the toxins to, you know, the
mm-hmm.
surface of the skin. So,
yeah. Before they, I hope they don't cut us off, but sometimes they'll cut us off before we finish. But do you have any more questions for Dr. Aleem?
Dr. Aleem, are you there?
Oh, yeah, we're here.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I was waiting to hear your voice again, actually. I guess the last question, well, two questions.
I was enjoying the bed.
Oh, okay.
Hard. Yeah.
What'd you say?
I said, y'all was building hard.
Okay.
Oh, I thought it got disconnected.
Thank
waiting
you.
To
yeah.
hear your voice again. Well, how long is the trial period is what one brother wanted to ask. How long is
the trial period
once you become initiated? Yes.
Trial period is a year. So it's
okay.
Actually not a trial period. It's actually an apprenticeship. So over
right.
the year, they would be learning various meditations and various other healing modalities. If mixed with the facilitators, they would be able to go to the facility by EMS and say, yeah, the same. In fact, matter of fact, this show tonight is dedicated to Grandmaster Sanyata Saraswati and Prince Bears.
Okay. And the last question that we'll have open now is about how some folks within religious, different religious thoughts or different ways of being, their clergy are recognized as diplomats by, you know, by the U.S. government. Is that something that is open to those ordained within ICRM?
Yes. We can definitely work on that. That is definitely something that we put together and get done on.
Okay. Yeah, I believe we spoke on that earlier about the clergy.
Mm-hmm.
The clergy really have they probably the ones I was speaking of earlier that would have a hard time, especially with the sweat lodge and the initiation process. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's some, but then again, don't be surprised that some of your clergy are actually that are into some of that, you know, some of the science that we're into. Also, it's just a shame that they don't share it with their congregations, you know.
Right.
They keep it to themselves, you know. And they might give their congregation just a little bit or a teaspoonful of what they know, you know. And the rest of it themselves all the way till they die and go to their graves with it.
Yes, I this information, you know, talking about it with folks that practice other things, you know, singularly, they practice one, you know, faith system, they will tell, yeah, well, you know, we're supposed to be recognized, all the members are supposed to be recognized as diplomats. It's like, okay, well, why aren't you then?
Mm-hmm.
Why aren't you? Why didn't you go and do that? You've been practicing. You know, I see you go every Sunday for the last 30, 40 years. What happened?
Right. You know.
You haven't. Why aren't you benefiting from the faith system? Not that it's all about the money or anything like that, but the, you know, as above, so below.
Right. You know. I was listening to C. Freeman Hill, peace be upon him, when he was talking one time, giving a lecture. On the DVD tapes I got, and they said they go into them churches without knowing anything, and come right back out, and don't learn anything before they went in. You know, haven't learned a thing. You know, or understanding of that Bible. You know, or anything. You know, their Christianity or what their religion is really supposed to be about. I mean, they go in just as ignorant as, you know, and come out just as ignorant before they went in.
Right.
And, you know, and to be really, not just the church, even the more science temples across the country, you know, the more science temples incorporated, what I'm talking about,
mm-hmm.
the one that has been compromised, they go in with the Circle 7. Without, you know, and come right back out and haven't learned anything more about that Circle 7, what they are supposed to learn before they went in. You know,
mm-hmm.
Because a lot of are under the 501c3 for one. So like I said, a lot of them been compromised, and they can only teach them so much, and that's it. They can't go with things any further. You know, because, you know, a lot of them grand chiefs or chiefs are probably afraid that they go to jail or whatever, and they shut their temples down. So that's, you know,
yeah,
a shame.
That is definitely a situation. The cap on the knowledge.
Yeah, no.
Yes.
No. And that's why they're in the shape they're in today. I had one sister that said that when we gonna get a school, you know, we here it is. When did he start a Canaanite temple? 1913. Here it is, 100 years. We still don't have one. You know, I mean, you know. Wow.
That's a very
frustrating
argument.
That
conversation is very frustrating when you talk about how long certain practices or certain when you ask certain questions about, you know, well, how long have you been in existence and what is it that you are able to provide your own members with now?
Mm-hmm.
That's a very frustrating discussion to have with some folks because of, you know, having been infiltrated and because of lack of, you know, progressive leadership and also the members, you know, lack of discipline. And also, not even that, in a lot of cases, they have had those, you know, they have made strides, and they definitely have, you know, overcome and progressed and everything, but then you have someone that can come in and just ruin all of that.
Right.
Because they don't have those high moral standards. They, you know, it's only about the money and only about, you know, what they can experience in this one physical incarnation.
Right.
That's, you know, and that I'm not sure if that has anything to do with the teachings failing, because, I mean, I've gotten a lot from a lot of different houses the teachings are very sharp, but it's a lot, and a lot of times it's the actual folks that are there that don't really practice what it is they preach, or don't really follow who they say they follow, or really don't have any intention from the start of truly, you know, emanating them, you know, that light that the teachings actually bring to them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the difference between, you know, someone that's a student and someone that just wants to lead, or someone that just wants to get what they can for themselves and have no intention of, you know, feeding the homeless and, you know, leaving anything for prosperity or having a legacy. It's just about what they can have right now. That's unfortunate, but that's, you know, that's not unique to any specific house of worship.
Right. Right. Not just the church, but the temples as well.
Right.
Some of your mosques, you know, and your synagogues, you know, they are, you know, the same thing, you know, goes on and on. You know, and they don't teach the esoteric part of what they should be teaching them, you know. And this is why every neighborhood, every Asiatic neighborhood across the country is still in the wretched condition that they're in, you know, because they don't know themselves. They're still keeping on living outside themselves because no one, not enough of us, people like us, will go around to teach them, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So you try to go to some of these temples, and a lot of the things you'll say may be rejected. I know it happened with me, you know.
Yeah.
And until I found out what was really going on, you know, then I found out, you know, like Dr. Aline explained it to me. Said, "Well, they have been compromised." So. And you go in there and try to talk, you know, things that you and I or Kadira talk about, and, you know, and say some things about Sister Val, you know, Sister Queen Valerie, you know.
Right. You know, this was on last week's Queen Valara, right?
Yeah, Queen Valara, and or even Taj to be Bay, you know. And they'll know, you know, they'll start snaring at you, you know, because they can't go there, you know.
Yes.
They stuck, you know.
That's true. That's why with the motto, "Know Thyself," is very important. And it doesn't come out of nowhere. That's an ancient condition, and it may even come from before them. We find the research that's a very ancient concept. Know thyself, and you'll know the universe and God. So, when you go into these practices, know thy. I mean, that tells you, you know, if just focusing on that, know thyself, thou shalt know the universe and God.
Ooh, yes.
Know thyself, which is all the nouns. Yourself, thyself. Universe, God, thyself, universe, God. You know, that once you get, you know, to the higher levels of that, it's very easy to differentiate, you know, someone with a colonized mind versus, you know, someone that's really striving to know themselves to really service other people. It's very clear. It becomes, you know, you don't have to have that conversation. Doesn't have to be very long at all.
Yeah. You know, as I explained earlier, it's not just the churches, the mosques, and the temples. It's the fraternal orders as well, like the Prince Hall Masonic Lodges, you know, and whatever and so on. You know, you come in there and try to teach them real, which is masonry, which is based off of Moorish science, you know, as well. And most of the time they are rejected. So they're stuck on this European watered-down Moorish comedic mystery system, which is a European watered-down system that they call Western Freemasonry.
Mm-hmm.
And they are not trying to hear that. What we're trying to teach them.
Right.
So that's that's a shame, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And because they don't really know what they really mean, really what it means to be a Mason, or what Mason really means. A lot of them, some of them even believe that Chaim Abel was a real person, you know.
Right.
it was a real Chaim Abel, you know. And I'm like, whoa. You know, and they go to their graves and die with that, you know, which is tragic. Because he is another solar allegory. You know, that's all he was, a solar allegory.
Mm-hmm.
But I know the word, you know, the Chaim Abel means. You know, it's fantastic.
Yes, that's something else I've noticed in getting involved with IFRAM, being able to notice different crimes that aren't even categorized as crimes, with something you just mentioned. Allowing, you know, being in religious authority and allowing your members to believe certain things until they die.
Yeah.
That right there, you can't go to jail for that. You can't be in prison for that. That's not, you know, you can't.
But it's a crime, though.
It is a serious karmic crime to know the truth and allow others to believe in a lie.
Yeah.
You know, and that alone is a sinful sin. And then outside of that, to do so that you personally benefit financially from it. That's on a whole different level.
Mm-hmm.
Of, you know, talk about the deadly sins. Oh.
Oh, yeah.
What do you call that? What do you call that?
Man, you know, just mental genocide. Emotional genocide, spiritual genocide, man.
Right.
On a mass scale, massive scale.
That's what Prince Aleem, that, you know, one question I had wanted to ask, I mean, as far as the last question, with the priests and priestesses, those that get initiated, once they have their own church, are they able to settle disputes amongst their members? Because, you know, with the court system, that I was told that originated within the church. The court systems actually originated within the church. So you would have your rabbi or your priest settle disputes if that person was charged with also being able to handle, you know, litigation according to religious customs. Is that something that IC.R.O.M. priests and priestesses are empowered to do?
Definitely. As a matter of fact, the church council actually would be also the judicial system, which they will be able to handle those particular matters. Of course, they will have to write to the local courthouse, the state, Secretary of State, get all that information filed there, as an indigenous court, so that they will be able to handle their own matters, you know, without interference. So these things we definitely will discuss and formulate more on. The thing right now is just getting people to understand how deep this thing really is, and for them to come on out so we can handle our business. And once again, that is 1 month from today, June 28th and 29th.
Uh-huh.
It will be next month. We will be having initiations into ICRO, which is the Indigenous Cosmic Golden RE Order of Mel-Chi-Zedek, put together by Prince Ramisis Abel Bey, who is Crown Prince of Empire Washitaw, Dugdahmoundyah, and the establisher of United Washitaw, Dugdahmoundyah, as well as also the establisher of this particular order. So please come out, check us out. You can call us at 910-364-9099. That's 910-364-9099. Check us out, come out, participate, and enjoy. If you're thinking that we go deep on the radio, for those who listen to our radio shows on a weekly basis. There's nothing when we have a green screen and we're able to put the information up in front of your face and go over the information, go over the meditation techniques, go over all this information right before you, and you participate and you get a chance to see how real this really is. Not something always that you heard about, but actually a way that you can practice from here on out.
Any more questions, sister?
No way.
Okay.
All right, I guess we're going to close on now. We got a few minutes left, so get ready to head out. We appreciate everybody for coming on tonight. Thank you, Brother Fahim, for coming on, being co-host. Thank you, Sister Jules, the goddess, for coming on and answering questions and asking questions concerning I.C.G.R.O.M. And once again, everybody, check us out June 28th, 29th. 1 week, 1 month from now, check us out for the initiation. For those interested, give us a call at 910-364-9099. It's going to be something serious, so give us a call. And we out, y'all.
Peace. All right, peace.
Peace. The mission in operation.